So do you guys have any idea what I'm going to talk to you about today?
The rock cycle.
The rock cycle. Do you guys understand the rock cycle?
Yeah.
You think you understand fully how the rock system works?
No.
No?
No.
So I don't know if you've heard about who I am, but I did a PhD in geology. And so for my project, I traveled South America on a motorcycle for 7 months. And I collected sand, because within almost all river sand is a little mineral called zircon, and it's as hard as diamond. So if it's as hard as diamond, you think it lasts very long?
Yes.
In fact, it's the oldest stuff we can find on Earth. We found some zircons that date back 4.4 billion years old. Is that very old? It wasn't. That was a very good statement. What's your name?
Colton.
Colton just said, wasn't that when the Earth was a big molten ball of flaming stuff? But think about this. That's a very good point. Because if it was a molten ball of flaming stuff, would we have crystals of zircon?
No.
They'd be molten, wouldn't they? Nah, that's a good question. Because in the field that I studied, they want to know, how far back can you go in Earth's history when there was continents and when there was crust and when things looked almost like it does today? Question or statement?
If diamonds are really hard, does it like form like diamonds do?
Nope, totally different. In fact, if there's a little bit of time, I'm going to go and do a little thing on the board here. Diamonds are weird. And so they don't really fit into our normal rock cycle. And so if there's some time, I'm going to explain to you how diamonds work. But believe it or not, if there's a diamond on the surface of the Earth, it had to travel the speed of sound getting shot totally vertical up to the crust. Isn't that crazy? So we're going to talk about that a little bit, if there's time. I don't think we're probably going to run out of time because we're trying to cram a lot of information. So you guys ready to dive into the rock cycle?
Yeah.
All right. So before I dive into this, I'm basically going to explain two major sides of the rock cycle. Do you guys know that there's two sides of it?
No.
All right. So you better listen up carefully so you see both sides. So let's talk about Earth's formation, exactly what you primed us for. So that's what primordial Earth looked like. And because we can find zircon that go back 4.3, 4.4 billion years ago, it probably, this goes farther back, doesn't it, when it was a molten ball of stuff. So any guesses how far back this picture was taken? I took this picture myself. Can you believe that? All right, maybe I didn't. What do you think?
How old the rock is?
That is a deep question. But a real quick and dirty answer is we use uranium that decays to lead, and we use that ratio in our machine. And if you can figure out the ratio, basically when uranium is producing lead, we can then back calculate how much lead we found to figure out the millions or billions of years it took to make that lead. And so we back calculate to what that uranium was at the beginning. Does that make sense? So it's just a nuclear clock. Does anybody here use GPS? Everybody's using a nuclear clock. So it's exactly the same, but I think in satellite atomic clocks, I think they use cesium. So they use the cesium that decays. We actually use uranium. Same exact technique. So this is what the Earth looked like at about 4.55 billion years ago, right? It's still getting bombarded by meteorites. But what's missing on this planet Earth for us to survive?
Water.
Yes.
And oxygen.
And oxygen. And what else?
Food. Sorry.
No, food will come with that. What do you think?
The atmosphere.
Exactly, the atmosphere. I'll call you next time. So it's missing all that stuff, right? So we're getting bombarded by atomic rays from the sun. We're getting bombarded by meteorites, all this stuff. We need an atmosphere to protect us, right? So I like to think of that molten Earth almost like a bubble. So you guys see that swirling bubble?
It's a bubble.
It's just our little soap bubble, right? Total side question, but you see the colors? We're going to jump forward in time. You guys watch what happens to the colors. You ready? Isn't that crazy? So what I want you guys to do, though, is when you're looking at this bubble, I want you to think about that swirling mass, right? And so if this is our molten Earth, this is all that lava that's swirling around the Earth, right? So I want you to visualize that this is a big blob of hot, wet, liquid rock, right? You guys want to see what happens if we jump farther forward?
Yeah.
Watch the color change. Whoa. Any guesses why the bubble changes colors? What do you think? Oh, no, no, this is totally separate from the analogy of the Earth. Why does a bubble change colors through time?
Maybe
because
the colors mix.
No. What do you think? No. So, real quick, totally aside, but the bubble's drying out. So you have two sides of soap with the water in between, and as those layers get closer together of the soapy layers, they change color. Totally beside the point. So look at this. This is a magma pool, and this is either, this one's in Hawaii. So if you guys ever go to the Mauna Loa up top, you can't get permission, but this is a camera looking down. So you guys see what the lava's doing? So think about each one of these things as its own hard plate now, right? So we've gone from that bubble where there's no hard plates, and now these plates have to basically behave with each other, right? So let's go to another place, and this is in the rift zone of Africa. See those same plates? Look at that. So tell me some of the directions that those plates are going in between each other.
They are kind of going that way and that way.
So they're spreading, right?
Left to right.
Yeah.
Yep,
so let's draw these out real quick. So if we have two plates, right? Those are two plates. So what you said is the plates could be opening up, right? What's another direction you guys saw?
I just have a comment on that. When they opened up, there was always like another one underneath.
Not another one, but the liquid stuff is hardening, right? So as those spread open, new material comes in and grows those plates, doesn't it? What's another direction you guys saw? So if we drew two plates, and that's the thing between the two plates, if they're going around, they might be sliding, right?
Yeah.
And what other direction did you guys see there? It was harder to see this last direction.
They were going under, and then they were coming back up.
So let's focus on what you just said, the first thing. If they're going under, right, then basically they're colliding, right? And one is going under the other. So that's all geology going on Earth. Did you know that? So everything you're going to learn about the rock cycle has to do with just plates on the Earth doing these different directions. Isn't that crazy? What do you guys think is causing all this motion inside the Earth?
How the lava has to really move.
Right. How is that moving? How's it? But inside the Earth, right, it can't flow, right? It only flows on the surface when it has, like, nothing holding it in. What do you guys think? What do you think?
Heat's trying to rise, so it's trying to break through.
Exactly. What's the name of heat rising within a liquid or a solution?
Yeah.
Check this out. So this is just hot red water placed in cold, clear water. Look what happens. Does anybody know what that's called? It starts with a C. In fact, some of our kitchens have an oven that specializes in this kind of heating.
Conventional.
Close. You're halfway there. The is correct.
Conversion.
Those are the two plates coming together. You're getting close, but kind of not really. Yes? Convection, exactly. So this is called a convection current, right? So basically, inside the Earth is really hot. And that heat, so we saw here, water that's the same stuff, but one that's hot and one that's cold, the hot stuff will rise within it, right? Because it's less dense. It's kind of like, it's lighter, right? We see that with wind, right? Our wind is formed when the sun heats up the Earth. All that hot air rises and creates all kinds of wind currents. So convection is what drives all of these plates. Does that make sense? It's pretty simple, isn't it? Just like that temperature change in that thing of water is the reason why all of our continents have formed, and why Earth is very unique compared to all the other planets in the solar system. Yes?
The reason why it goes up is because when something's heated, its molecules move faster, and when something's cold, it slows down.
Exactly. So when the molecules are moving faster, it kind of gets bigger, doesn't it? And that means it's lighter or it's less dense. Dense is the correct scientific word, but if you guys haven't heard of density, I'm using the word light. And so that stuff with the fast-moving molecules will actually rise if stuff around it is slow-moving molecules and it's actually smaller volume. So that's what the Earth would look like if we cut a sliver right through it. So just like that convection current we saw in the water, we can actually see within the mantle. You see that? So hot rises, and those plumes will come out like that. So think about that. If you have that giant rising current, for us it's magma. In the water, it was just water. But if you have that rising current, right, and it gets to the surface of the earth where the crust is, what's going to happen? Not yet, but let's think about this. If this is our surface of the earth, right, and so I'll draw your little core, you have this rising column of magma, what happens when it hits the surface? It does that, doesn't it?
Yeah.
And so just like you guys saw with that molten magma video, it's going to pull the crust apart, isn't it?
Yeah, and pull the magma.
So it's going to do this, isn't it? But can it do that around the entire earth? Is our earth growing? It is? Last time I checked, it's staying the same size. So if it can't do this all the way over the, around the earth, what do you think is happening over here? Some of it has to get shoved back into the earth, doesn't it? So that's our earth. Is that round?
No.
I know, I tried. So that plate's going that way, and that plate's going that way, right? So if we make new crust on earth, we also have to destroy old crust, don't we? And it's all driven by those convection currents. Question?
Isn't it called subduction?
It is. In fact, we're going to get to it. So, big question is, how have we gone from that molten ball of earth to what we see today? So when do you guys think this picture was taken?
It wasn't.
Good catch.
Yeah.
So do we have oceans yet?
No.
You guys just told me we need oceans, right? We don't have oceans. Do we have an atmosphere yet?
No.
So this is still like 4.5 billion years ago. This is not very long into the birth of the earth. How about this? Look at that. That has all of the stuff we need to live on earth, doesn't it?
Yeah.
So you see the blue sky, so it has atmosphere. What are these guys right here? Wrong. What is a meteorite that's all ice?
Comet.
Right. So the idea is either all the water for our oceans came out of our rocks or it had to come from outer space. And so there's signs that we got water from both. And then finally, what's the last thing we need for life to occur on Earth? What do you guys see on the screen? Somebody new. What do you see? Exactly. So some guy ran some experiments using just sparks with all the stuff that would be in our oceans. We actually started to grow basically amino acids. So we've gone through what's going on inside of the earth to form all these different plates. So now we have this hard crust, right? And because we have these convection currents that's driving that crust, we know what's going on, right? What are the two terms that somebody threw around? When they're coming together, what's that called? Subduction, and when they're opening up, I said the word. Convection drives the plate spreading, right? So we have those two. In that, you guys, we've now set up the foundation for our rock cycle. Does that make sense? So that's the conveyor belt system that's going to create and destroy all the rocks that we see on Earth, more or less.
Bye-bye.
So check this out. This is going back almost 500 million years ago, and this is what our continents have done on the Earth. Do you guys know that? Isn't that crazy? So the Earth's crust is this crazy dynamic thing that's always shifting. Did you guys know that? So do you guys remember the name of the last supercontinent? What do you think?
Pangaea.
Nice work. Pangaea, and that's what it looked like. So what you guys are looking at is Pangaea. Now, from what you guys just saw, here comes your trick question. Are you ready? So of Pangaea, we have what's called a supercontinent, right?
Yeah.
So pretty much all of the continents were one giant supercontinent, right?
Yeah.
So you ready for your trick question?
Yeah.
What is this blob right here going to turn into?
What's that? Africa and South America.
Nope. Ooh, you're right on the last one. So if you guys watch, this is going to be South America. And what do you think this blob up here is going to turn into? Somebody, what do you think? If this is South America, what do you think this is going to be over here? North America. You guys ready to watch? Let's see if you're right. And somebody say action.
Action!
Here we go. Pay attention. Pangaea is still coming together. Boom, it starts rifting apart. Look at North America's already separated, huh? Here comes South America. Drum roll, please. Look at that. So you guys, what ocean is this right here? What ocean is this? It's the Atlantic. So is the Atlantic growing or shrinking? So if that's the case, what's the opposite side of the Atlantic? Pacific. Is that growing or shrinking?
Shrinking.
So think about that, you guys. We're getting closer to China and Russia and Japan, and we're getting farther away from Africa and Europe. Isn't that crazy? So think about that. If we wait long enough, we'll be part of China.
No.
How long do you think we'll have to wait?
No.
So, you guys ready for another trick question, testing your math abilities? Shh. So if it took 250 million years for us to get basically in the middle between Atlantic and Pacific, how many more millions of years is it going to take us to run into China? What do you think?
250 million.
Nice work. How'd you get that? He said 250 million years. Why do we know that? Took us 250 million years to get in the middle, right? So it's going to take us another 250 million years to get to the end. Exactly. All right. So this is just a real quick schematic to show you what it looks like down on the Earth. So doesn't that look just like our water current?
No.
What's the name of that?
It's bubbling.
What is that current called with a C?
Convection.
Convection. So that's driving that. Now look at that. Exactly what I drew here. So there's our subduction zone. What we said at the beginning is that spreading creates new crust, right? And the subduction creates recycling. So that's what shoves all that old crust back into the ocean, back into the earth. See how there's one plate going underneath another plate? What do you guys think is happening along that, right between those two plates? Exactly, earthquakes, right? So where are the most destructive earthquakes on Earth? Alaska's one.
California.
They're not that destructive compared to other magnitudes around the world.
And the Ring of Fire.
The Ring of Fire. And what is the Ring of Fire?
I don't know.
It's a subduction zone, right?
Yeah, subduction.
Subduction is where it's going back down into the Earth. The big question is, how do we know about subduction? So geologists, so think about an earthquake like a vibration, right?
Yeah.
So you throw that pebble into the pool, you see those waves?
Yeah.
So that could be water waves, that can also be sound waves, right?
Yeah.
So if you think about that pebble hitting the water, just like the shift of the earth, whoop, it's going to send out waves, right?
Waves.
And so we can think of these waves, for you guys, two nice general kinds of waves. And I have a slinky for this. So I need two volunteers. How about you?
Yes.
How about you? Come on up. So you get to hold this side, and you get to hold this side. So I want you to step back a little bit and so it doesn't sag very much. So what I guys want you to see is this slinky is now air, okay? And so when we make a sound wave, these are like our different air particles, okay? So there's two kinds of sound waves we're going to talk about. We're going to talk about one that's the pressure wave. So when somebody makes noise, watch this. You ready? Ready?
Yes.
You guys all ready?
Yes.
Perfect silence. I think you guys are ready. See that? Do you see that pressure wave go forward and back? So that's what we call P waves. So P for pressure. But if that was the earthquake, it travels pressure straight through, right? The next is what's called an S wave. All right, you guys are shaking it, busted. So the S wave I like to think of as a sideways wave. So watch this. So it would basically be, if you want to do it, you can do it, you ready? So what I want you to do is quickly shake your hands back and forth. So you see that wave? So don't go, that's too big of an amplitude. What I want you to do is really quick and small. Wait. And action. There you go. Now what's going on? So you see how that S wave works? And so geologists are able to measure both of these waves with what's called a geophone. You guys see that on the ground here?
Yeah, I need you to stand up. Okay, jump up and down. Okay, that's how strong the wave is from way back there. Okay, stop, sit down. Okay, now you stand up here, and you jump up and down.
Jeez!
That the closer you are, the stronger the signal it gets to the geophone. Okay? No? Okay, what I need all of you to do to stand up. Okay, ready, set, jump!
And it's broken.
Okay, now, jump until I tell you to stop. So you guys just created a seismic event.
So you can tell your parents you guys made an earthquake today. So you guys want to see how we use those in geology? All right, so I'm going to need some volunteers that haven't volunteered yet. How about you? Come on up. So you can stand here. So this is your challenge. You've got to blindfold yourself so you can't look. All right? Now, somebody has to make sure she's not peeking. How about you? Make sure she's not peeking. Okay, now, this has to be the quiet part. I'm going to point to somebody. You're going to stand up quiet as you possibly can be. And when I do this, you're going to go, hey, okay? Sound good?
Just once.
All right, so somebody that we haven't talked to yet.
Hey.
So now you get to tell us where she was. You got to point in that direction. So she's pretty close, right? Now this is the hardest part of that. Now you got to tell us how far away she was. The full room, half a room, quarter of the room. Pretty close to the front. So you guys see how it's very difficult with only one. So now what she is, she's our geophone, right? She's our microphone that was listening for that earthquake. The earthquake was over here, but it's very difficult to tell distance. So you ready? You can open your eyes for a minute. So now I need another volunteer. You want to volunteer? So stand up over here. So this is our second geophone, okay? So you have to keep your eyes closed, right? Now you got to keep your eyes closed. Now we got to find a second earthquake. Okay, you guys point where you heard that. Good direction over here. So now you guys see how their paths cross, right? But now you guys tell us how far away you think that was.
I'd say about quarter of the room.
Quarter of the room. So that would put her about right here. How far do you think it was? Half of the room. Dang, you're good. She's getting better. So that gets a pretty good location, right? So what we've done is we've gone from one geophone to two geophones. We're getting more accurate, right? Now we need a third volunteer right back there. Pokemon, go ahead and stand up. All right, you can open your eyes for a second. So you guys, eyes are open. So now we have three geophones, okay? Now think about this. Now our geophones are going to plug their eyes. No opening your eyes. Now we need an earthquake. Did you guys hear that? Now point where you thought you heard that sound. So now look at this. Now watch this, you guys. So geophones, you can open your eyes. If I arrange myself to, oops, sorry about that. Where you're pointing, look at that. Where keep your pointing, geophones. Look at that. With three geophones, I can find the exact location of that earthquake. Look at this. With three geophones, we can tell exactly where the earthquake occurred. Isn't that cool? So it's just like satellite telemetry, right? Your GPS cannot work until it gets three satellites.
Triangulation.
Triangulation, exactly. So as geologists, if we have three geophones or more, we can not only tell where it was, but how deep within the Earth's surface it occurred.
Whoa.
So check this out. One of the first set of researchers realized that these earthquakes, right along the coast, they all of a sudden start getting deeper and deeper within the earth as you come inside the continent. So what do you think they were finding out? What was the first thing they realized?
That the tectonic plates were rubbing against each other and causing
earthquakes. Exactly. Does that make sense to you guys? So if we know that things are slipping to create earthquakes, and we know it's getting deeper as it moves within the continent, then what do you think we're finding out here? Finding out a subduction zone, right? And so just using these geophones, we were able to look deep within the earth. We can go hundreds of miles now and hear what's going on down there. And so this is what allowed us to figure out why the rock cycle works the way it does. So you guys ready to dive into that?
Yeah.
All right. So I like to think of rocks like a cookie.
Where's the...
So you guys ever, has anybody ever here seen a chocolate chip cookie? So I like to think, okay, there's a. I like to think of a normal rock, like we say on Mount Lemmon, like a cookie. So a rock, like a cookie, is composed of a bunch of different parts, right? So the rock is composed of all the minerals, whereas a chocolate chip cookie could have chocolate chips. This might have some raisins. This actually has little globs of peanut butter. We got this from Beyond Bread. So think about this. So I hope you guys, from now on, know when you're referring to a mineral, you're referring to something that is the same throughout it, right? Just like a chocolate chip. Chocolate chip is chocolate all throughout. Whereas a rock is the composition of all those minerals. Does that make sense? Anybody want to take a bite?
No.
There you go. All right, so I want you guys to be thinking chocolate chip cookie when you look at a rock. If you refer to a mineral, I hope you know that a mineral is the same thing throughout its entire body. Excuse me. So I also like to think of the earth like Italian dressing. Have you guys ever had Italian dressing?
Yeah.
Couple of yeah. What's the first thing you have to do with your Italian dressing before you pour it on your salad? Why do you have to shake it? Exactly. The good stuff? You gotta mix it up to get the good stuff on top, huh? And what happens if you're mixing up your Italian dressing and then your brother or sister gets you distracted before you get to pour it on your salad? What happens? It separates again, doesn't it?
Yeah, then you get frustrated.
Well, think about this, you guys. The earth behaves the same exact way. So I have some rocks here.
Can I bite it?
So this is like a pumice. Anybody ever heard of pumice? So our earth is like a salad dressing. And so pumice is what comes out of the volcano first. It's filled with gases, but it's also a lot lighter or less dense than stuff below it. So I'm going to pass around this piece of pumice. You guys ready? I'll start with you. Be very careful with these samples, please. Do not break them. Lightly pass them to your neighbor. I don't want to find these with chips. I don't want to hear them drop. I don't want to hear somebody's finger go, ow! Okay? When I'm passing these around, I want you guys to try and feel the density. Do you guys know what density is? What is density? It's kind of how light or how heavy it is, but it's the lightness and the size, right? And so this is obviously a lot bigger. That's why I want you guys to understand that there's a size and a heaviness. This is a lot smaller, but if you think about holding this size of this, you'll realize, wow, this is much denser than this. Ready? So that is a pumice. This is a granite. So go ahead and pass that around. So what's going to be on top, the pumice or the granite? Somebody who's already held them. Or you can say it. Pumice is going to be on top, right? What's even crazier? Can I see that real quick?
Let me see. There's an eyeball on it.
There is an actual marker for a test. I stole these from the university's test in their rock sciences. So right now, you guys, there's kids going, where's rock sample 8? But don't tell them, okay? So this is another crazy thing. Rocks, I'm going to pass you a granite and an andesite. Chemically, they're almost identical. So as you're passing this around, you're not only noticing density, but you're also noticing the minerals. And what's crazy is the only thing that separates these two is the time they sat in the earth. If it sits for a while, it grows nice, large minerals. If it doesn't sit for a while, very small minerals, mainly almost like a lava, almost like a mixture, okay? So I'll pass. So those two are basically the same chemicals. And then finally, just like our Italian dressing, as we get deeper into the earth, we get something called a peridotite. So you guys ready for this one? This one is super heavy. You ready for this? Better not drop it. So because this one is super heavy, we really only can find peridotites when a big eruption has occurred and actually dragged these up faster than they can settle back down into the magma. So we do not find these normally on Earth. We only find these in those really special circumstances that have ripped these off at death and from death brought them up quickly before they could sink back down. So realize when you're passing this around, this usually sits down almost 40 miles below us.
Whoa.
What you guys have just seen and are passing around is one side of the rock cycle. What does it come out as? What does it come up as? Comes up as like a magma, right? Comes up as a magma and it separates out by those densities we were talking about, right? And so how does it go from the mountains and get taken from the mountains down back into the ocean to start the second part of our cycle? How do we flatten those mountains? Or basically, what is doing the work to do all that?
Machine.
No. That's not happening. What do you think? Yes. We'll get to that a little bit later. So what do you guys think? How are we breaking down the mountains and getting all that mountain material into the oceans?
It rains and then just washes away.
Rain is a very good hint. But what is the rain, or how is that rain actually breaking down the rocks? What do you think? How is it eroding it? So there's three kinds of erosion. There's two that are real obvious that I have some cool slides of. So there's two main things that do all the breakdown of rocks. Ice and salt. A little bit of water in a crack, right? It freezes. Look what happens. You're going to see it again. So it made the crack bigger, didn't it? Can a bigger crack hold more or less water? So when that water freezes, what does it do? Opens it even more, doesn't it? So over thousands of years, those cracks actually shatter rocks.
No.
Look at that. So that happens in real cold, rainy environments, right? Are we in a cold, rainy environment here?
No.
So how could salt do that same thing?
What do you think?
It gets dissolved
by water.
Yep.
Nice work. What's your name?
Connor.
Connor just said exactly what happened. So salt can dissolve into water, right? That watery, that salty water goes into a crack. The water evaporates, doesn't it? When a salt crystal grows, it expands as well. So salt going into cracks actually does the same thing and over thousands of years breaks those cracks out bigger and bigger. So in the desert, all these rocks are being broken down just by drying out. Isn't that crazy? As long as you can get a little bit of salt into that water, once it dries, it's going to actually blow those rocks apart. And so that's why when you go to places like this, you'll find these huge boulders that are split right down the middle. Isn't that amazing? So think about that. All that stuff gets broken down off of the top of the mountains, and it travels into the ocean. How does it get to the ocean? Two main ways. You said it. And what's the other one? Wind, right? So you blow all that sediment into the ocean and it basically, does it sink to the bottom or does it rise to the top? Sinks to the bottom, doesn't it? So if you have an ocean bottom full of all this sediment, right? We've taken it off the mountains and we put it into the ocean. And that's why our oceans get deeper, doesn't it? And so now all of our ocean bottoms are covered in sediment, right? And now we just have to figure out a way to get that sediment back down inside the earth. Can anybody think of a way? How can you get ocean sediment shoved back down into the earth? It's on the board. What do you think?
Subduction.
Exactly. So think about that. If we have all this material coming off our mountains, bottom of the ocean, look at that. The subduction will take it right back down for us. Isn't that crazy? So when you take things like just sands and clays, everything you guys go to the ocean and play with, all that mud, you can make new rock just by adding more pressure and more temperature. You guys want to see one of the lowest temperature rocks you can form with muds and clays? All right, this one is from Mother Earth herself. Isn't that crazy? You guys want me to pass these around if you guys haven't seen a bowl before? So think about that, you guys. That's why it's called stoneware, right? Because what you're doing with the clay is you're basically subducting it down into the earth and just applying a lot of temperature in the kiln. Isn't that crazy? So, you guys know what nature's exact replica of this is? A siltstone or a slate. No, a slate. So isn't that crazy? All we're doing when we make pottery is just making a bowl-shaped stone that you guys can see all over the place. So think about this, you guys. The farther that you can subduct all that material down into the earth, you make different rocks. So near the surface, you'll have these sandstones, siltstones, shales. But as you get deeper into the earth, you'll get these things called granulites all the way down. So let me pass these things around. So I'm going to pass you guys some of these sandstones. So that red one's a sandstone. This is a shale. Here you go. Got to keep passing. There you go. There you go. And then if you can take this stuff and subduct it way down in the earth and subject it to huge pressures and temperatures, you get this really weird rock called an eclogite. So the coolest thing is, as a geologist, if you stumble upon eclogite, you realize that you're finding a rock that was shoved down sometimes almost 60 miles deep. Isn't that crazy? And what do you think is the big thing that shows you that it's an eclogite? From that distance, what do you guys see? What color is it?
Green.
It's really green. Isn't that cool? So go ahead and pass that around. And you'll notice, because it's been so deep within the earth, you'll notice that it's also kind of dense. So as a geologist, when you stumble upon eclogite, you realize that you're in an old subduction zone that was a big one. So big that it could get it down there and pressurize it. Yep, peridotite.
That's also
green. That's green, but that's olivine. This stuff's a little different. This is called oomphocyte, that mineral, the green mineral. So, do you guys see both cycles? So what's the first cycle based off of? It's based off our volcano, right? Bringing that magma up. And what's our second cycle that we just discussed? What's that based off of? Basically shoving it back down, huh? So one was liquid magma rising and forming different rocks. The other one was taking those muds and shoving them back down. Does that make sense, that whole cycle? And now our cycle's complete, right?
Yeah.
We made rocks as we brought them out of the earth, and then we made rocks as we shoved them back down into the earth. Is that pretty cool? So now you guys know the carbon cycle? You guys heard about that? You know the hydrologic cycle? Now you guys know the rock cycle. Everything's complete. Think of those pressures, okay? So these arrows denote a very big pressure down there, right? So if their rocks are under those pressures, as they rise, are those pressures going greater or lesser?
Lesser.
Much lesser. You see how the arrows get smaller? So now you have this rock that's no longer contained. So what do you think happens as it gets near the surface?
It goes faster.
It goes faster until... What's happening right here?
It bursts.
A burst, a volcanic eruption. So you guys want to see a simulated volcanic eruption?
Yeah!
All right, for that we have to go outside because we're going to get extremely wet.
Leave the rocks.
Okay, is everybody listening?
Yeah!
First thing I'm going to say, we are not exploding soda here. We're putting liquid nitrogen into the bottle.
What's going to happen when I put the cap on it?
It's gonna go.
Pressure's going to build, isn't it? So I'm going to put that into the water, and then we're going to watch what happens when this container can't take the pressure anymore, okay?
No, feel the ground.
Oh, we're getting wet. We're getting wet.
You guys ready? Give us a countdown from 10,
10
9,
9,
8. 8. Wow. Are you guys listening?
Yeah.
So the first one that you guys saw, the water level is right here, okay? Now, the water level's right here.
Take a picture of Caitlin getting.
So I want some observations of what that water level change does to our eruption, okay? You guys ready to take notes?
Yeah.
You guys all have your notepads out and pencils?
No.
Just kidding. Here we go. Ready? Countdown. 9, 8, 7, 6. Wow! all right, quiet down. So, did you guys get wet? All right. So, last second, scientists, any observations? What did less water do to our eruption? Was it higher or lower?
Higher.
Now, why do you think that occurred?
Because less water was less dense, so it made it go higher. Instead of having more water, which would
exactly. So what he's saying is, if you have too much water on top, it restricts all that eruption going up, right? You'd reduce the water, more pow.